counselors are really worried about is who's going to be the next king. The king went out into the desert. He didn't take any food with him. He didn't take a sword with him. He didn't take any guards with him. So the counselors all figured after 40 days, well, the king must be dead. He's not coming back. And they began to position themselves for earthly power and wealth. The only thing they were concerned about is who was going to be the next king. So the counselors hear about the king performing miracles, and they decide, well, we're going to bring him in. We want him to perform miracles for us. So they send the guards out. The guards bring him into the throne room. The counselors are gathered around, and they start to ask him, you know, perform the miracles. But the king can't do that, right? Because actually what has now happened, the counselors don't recognize it, but it's actually the counselors who have become blind. Counselors are now going to become blind, and the king can't heal them because they don't actually want to be healed. All they're really still worried about is power and wealth and becoming king. And when the king is unable to provide, to produce miracles for them, they get mad at them, and they leave the room, and they consult among themselves, and they say, you know what, we can't really send this guy back out into the city. If he continues to go through the city doing miracles, he's a threat to us. He's a threat to our power base. The people will like him and love him more than they love us, and we can't have that. We want our power. So rather than releasing him back into the city to continue his ministry, they kill him. Now you can open your eyes. And I would invite you to look upon Jesus on the cross and understand that, well, what I was telling you sounded like a fairy tale. It was no fairy tale at all. It was actually a true story. All right, the king I'm talking about is Jesus. It's not only a true story, but it's an ongoing story. It's a story that's still unfolding and taking place, right? We just experienced Easter. Right? We just experienced on Thursday night, we experienced the priests washing feet, just as the king I described washed the feet of the blind beggar that he came across. Right? We just experienced the counselors in power putting the good king to death. The story unfolds for us over and over and over. Right? We know the good king, oh, he's victorious. If you look at this picture over here, we see Jesus risen. Right? The good king is ultimately. So why do I tell you all of this, right? Why do I take the time to tell you this story? So when Father Vince came and saw us the day after we lost Aiden, he said something that I found very profound. He said, you know, God's time is not our time. From our perspective, if we think about Aiden, we think about all the things that he's not going to get to do, right? The marriage that he children that he won't have. And it makes us very, very sad. But from God's perspective, Aiden's earthly work was done. Right? The reason that I asked Kathy to talk about it, and you didn't say the same thing that you said to us that night, was she said, I think maybe one of the reasons God took Aiden away is because he could better perform the work that he needed to do from heaven than he could from here. The very work of service that she described, that he would be better suited to do that from heaven. So from God's perspective, right, Aiden's earthly work was complete. That story, that conversation that you had with him, right, indicated that Aiden had figured out what he was supposed to do. And basically what he was supposed to do was emulate the good king. Right, what he described to you that he was going to do was he was going to be of service to other people. He was going to love other people. Which is what Jesus did. That's what that on the cross, Jesus hanging on the cross, is the greatest demonstration of love any of you will ever experience, any of you will ever see. This love is unconditional. It's available at all times. It will never be withdrawn. It's always available to all of us. No matter how much you're hurting right now, and you might be hurting for reasons totally separate. Right? You might be hurting because this reminds you of somebody that you lost. Or you might be thinking about somebody that you know that's suffering right now. Or whatever it might be. Right? love remains available to you unconditional at all times. That's what the cross means. Right? So what I know about Aiden, which Kathy's story confirms for me, which I already felt about, was that he was this kid on the cusp. Right? He was still very childlike. He was still very innocent. But he was also reaching the point in time where he was going to find his way and find his momentum. He knew what he wanted to do. He knew that he wanted to emulate the servant king. He wanted to be somebody who loved, right, and served his fellow man. The reason I ask you all to come together, right, is because we are, despite the fact that we come from a bunch of different places like I described at the beginning, we're a single community. So you look at the person next to you who wasn't sitting next to you before, you have really one responsibility in this world, and that's to love that person, to serve that person. Right? That's why I asked you all to come together, so that we would be sitting close together as a single united community. That's what Aiden did. Right? Father Vince talked about, well, we know that God's time is different than our time. One of the things he said is, we may not understand what Aiden's purpose was. But here, I'm here to tell you, here's a couple things Aiden's accomplished. First of all, I'm standing here talking to you, giving you this message. Right? There's only one way I can be here. Aiden made this possible for me to be here and talk to you like this. So there's the very first thing that we know he accomplished. Joyous, yes, but also loving. Loving like this kind of love. Willing to give himself. Willing to give of himself for those around him. We've had so many stories people have come up with us and said, you know, when I was in grade school, I was in a really bad spot. Literally dozens of stories. So that already at age 17, he had been doing this. He had been emulating Jesus. So what this comes down to, right, is what are we going to do? What are we going to do going forward? Do we understand that really there's a choice in front of us? We can be the wicked counselor. We can be worried about accumulating wealth and power and earthly advantage. Or we can be the servant king, servant leader. This is the story of mankind. It goes all the way back to Adam. This is the lesson of the garden. Do you want to be God, or do you want to be a servant? Now, the first few times I said this, I was talking to high school kids. Right? They're the future. Right? But you know what? Those of us who are adults, we still have the same responsibility. And frankly, we haven't been real great at it real often. But we need to find a way. Find a way to come together. Right? We need to find a way to not make our differences separate us. Okay. So this is what I'm going to give you. This challenge, right? This challenge that what your responsibility is in this world. Choose to emulate Jesus on the cross. Okay. So the last thing I want to do is I want to assure everybody that God has been with us through all of you this entire time. We've also experienced a couple things that have been profound related to this. Last Sunday, Sister Agnes Marie, who's our spiritual advisor for my Franciscan fraternity, called me about 1:15 in the afternoon, and she said, we're going to come over in a little while, we're going to go over and visit, is that okay? I said, sure. And I was sitting at my desk, and I looked on my computer to check my email. And when When I checked my email, one of my friends had emailed me. He's been in Spain for the past 2 years, Paul Dean. And Paul Dean emailed me on Sunday at the exact same time that sister called me. We just got to Assisi. We just lit candles for Aiden at the foot of the San Damiano crucifix, which is the crucifix that spoke to St. Francis. Right? Told him to go in, to go and rebuild the church. Now I'm telling you that this is not coincidence. This was prearranged. This was God speaking to me. I emailed Paul back and I said, you realize that God just spoke directly to me and you were the messenger. And then I went crying. When I was at St. Joe Wednesday morning, and I was given this same basic talk to the student body, there came a point in time where I said to the student body, you know, whatever it is that's troubling you, Jesus is there for you. And if you're not sure about that, if you need help understanding that, call me. For all the support you've given me, the least I can do is take that call. And my phone rang in my pocket at that exact point in time. And I had turned my phone off before Mass started. I'm sure I turned it off. And then when we picked up Brendan yesterday, Brendan said, you know, I got the news the third day.
Can you hear me in the back? All right, good. So I was on day 3 of a 10-day FTX in Ranger School when I was